My name is Mike Collins. I was the command module pilot on Apollo 11, which was the first lunar landing in 1969, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin being my two compatriots there. There was a lot of polarization in 1969, just as there is today. One difference was President John F. Kennedy, who was very clear in his stated mandate to land a man on the moon and return him safely to the Earth by the end of the decade. So there was no doubt about what we were going to do and when we were supposed to do it. Now, the how of it was up to us, and that's what we spent a decade working very hard at to achieve the first lunar landing before the end of the decade, just as he said. Well, I don't know if he was a good leader or not. In many ways, he was wonderful for the space program, and I liked him. I never met him, but I admired him as a person. We were not friendly with the Soviet Union. Paris Air Show was a neutral territory. I expected perhaps a tinge of hostility from them. I got none. We concentrated more on the fact that we had similarities in our background rather than political different systems in our background. They flew airplanes, we flew airplanes. We lived in the sky, they lived in the sky. We concentrated more on those similarities than our political differences. And as people, I got along very well with Pavel Fyodorov, I believe his name was. He seemed like someone that I could go out and have a beer with on very friendly terms. And for the moment, at least, we forgot the latent hostility between the United States and the Soviet Union. We felt that the eyes of the world were upon us. It was something that we had every opportunity to mess up, to do, make a mistake. We were, at least I was, uptight in that regard. I was trying to do everything exactly as I had been trained to do, and I knew that if I messed up somehow, there would be not only national but international repercussions because of that. I think that Americans were very proud of their space program, the fact that we successfully landed on the moon. However, it was not the be-all and the end-all of their existence. People's lives go on. The space program happened. It receded into the background. It did not change the United States fundamentally, nor could it. We didn't try to change anything fundamentally. We were proud to be part of the country. It did have some problems at the time, but relatively minor. And the spacecraft was, or the space program, excuse me, was a relatively small indicator of change. In quarantine, we had a large colony of white mice. The scientists were worried that we'd brought back pathogens, dangerous pathogens from the moon, and therefore the ultimate success of our mission depended on the health of these white mice. So I just sort of made fun of that here and there. But it was a real consideration. If the white mice had died, something, we had brought back something very, very dangerous. Dangerous, how dangerous, I don't know. I think Neil said, well, the chances of our doing that were infinitesimally small, but the implications of the dangers of our doing it were the other end, meaningful beyond all belief. If you took a tiny number and you multiply it by a huge number, what did you get? I don't know. You got some kind of quantity that the authorities thought were worth building this gigantic building full of white mice to ascertain. That's all. And so I like to make fun of the. Yeah, I like to say, when it's all over and done with, the success of Apollo was not of man, it was, that famous book of Mice and Men. This was really of mice. Okay, the success of Apollo 11 depended on mice, okay? In going to the moon, as I did on Apollo 11, people usually want to know what I thought of the moon, how impressed I was, moon. And of course, that was our destination, and I was mightily impressed to see it in its entirety by myself behind the moon. It was a wonderful experience. However, far more important than the moon, I thought, was my view of the Earth, tiny little object, about, you can blot it out with your thumbnail, but it pops right back when you move your hand, and there it is, blue and white, tiny, shiny, a smear of rust, where those things we call continents, and our home, the main show, never mind the moon. Okay, goodbye moon, there is the Earth. It is a whole show. And its fragility is the quality. I mean, the blue and the white and all of that, I expected that, but somehow it projected an aura of fragility that I did not expect. That was totally strange. But the more I thought of it on the way back from the moon, the more I realized, ooh, fragile it is. This Earth is very, very fragile. And we have so many ways of interrupting or negating that fragility in so many different technical ways today. We have to be very careful. We're not taking really top-notch care of our Earth, and we should do a better job. People of all countries, persuasions, politics, etc., we need to get united behind an Earth fragility movement. You know, I'd be a liar or a fool if I said I had the best seat on Apollo 11. However, I can say with absolute truth and equanimity, I'm happy with the seat that I had. I was proud to be a part of Apollo 11. It was the culmination of President John F. Kennedy's dream of putting a man on the moon. And we did it on Apollo 11. I was an integral part of it. I was Neil and Buzz's meal ticket home. I was happy to have the seat that I had. I worked for 6 years at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, specifically for the Air and Space Museum for the first four of those 6 years. And it was a wonderful project to bring a museum into the National Mall there. I've always been a fan of the Smithsonian. I'm also a fan of Washington, D.C., and I was a fan of this bicentennial because that's what President Kennedy had said that he wanted us to do. So I kind of linked the two together. A man on the moon by the end of the decade, a museum on the Mall by the bicentennial. And in those years, I was trying to get money from the Congress to achieve that. And linking those two things together was helpful. The main help I had was a senator named Barry Goldwater. He was a wise man up on Capitol Hill, and he was a great assistance in all the circumlocutions of the political process and how to translate that into money to get this museum built, which we did get built, just barely in time for the bicentennial, and a $40 million project came in on time and below price. Well, climate change is one reality that is gaining credence in that it is a reality and not just some mad scientist somewhere has decided that his backyard is a little bit hotter than it was a decade ago. It's a real problem. It is a real problem, especially for the lateral parts of our civilization. Miami Beach, for example, is starting to experience rising seas that are, oh my gosh, affecting the price of real estate. Now that will get people's attention. And as things like that spread across our society, some of these environmental concerns will become a matter of reality and of great importance. And so I back the people who are trumpeting the alarms today and saying we're going to have to do something about our various patterns of human consumption to mitigate the encroaching oceans and the rising thermometers. After the flight of Apollo 11, we were privileged to make an around the world trip, and I was flabbergasted by the reception that we got as we went from place to place. People everywhere felt that they were closely involved with that. I guess the news coverage of it was phenomenal, but it wasn't, well, you Americans finally did this, that, or the other. It was we humans finally left the surface of this planet. We moved into space, we did it, and there was a unity, there was an emotional unity that I would like to see recreated. Now, how you recreate that, I do not know. Perhaps a flight to Mars would help along those lines. Well, my hope is that NASA will increase the importance of going to Mars sometime soon. I used to joke after the flight of Apollo 11 that they sent me to the wrong planet, that NASA should be renamed the National Aeronautics and Mars Administration, and I do think our focus should be on Mars. An extremely complex undertaking makes the Apollo program look like child's play. It's a 2-year round trip because of the juxtaposition of the orbits of the Earth and of Mars, but it's the closest thing that we have to a sister planet, and I really am very happy that we seem to be pointed in that direction.